It's November 6, 2011, and this is a conference call with the Release and Reclaim support group. And I'm Marlene Winell, and we're here with Dr. Valerie Tarico, our special guest. And today's topic is, do feelings validate beliefs? And we have seven other people that are on the call that are members of this group in various places all over the country and in a couple of other countries. So welcome everybody. And why don't we start with Valerie? You've written about this and you've done a lot of thinking about this and contributing. So that's why we've asked you to come talk about it, because this has been a question and a source of anxiety for lots of people, including folks that are here on the call. So why don't you start with sharing what some of your findings and conclusions are, and then we'll have a discussion about it.
Thanks, Marlene. Marlene asked me to talk about this subject for a couple of reasons. One is because, as I think most of you know, because she shared it with you, I wrote a chapter a few years back called Christian Beliefs Through the Lens of Cognitive Science, in which I specifically focused on the relationship between our cognitive architecture and the way that emotions kind of happen and the way that emotions get developed in our brains, and then how that relates to kind of Christian belief, and also how Christianity historically and in a modern context, and very specifically, it works to elicit certain kinds of emotions that then make belief seem like the only possible course of action. So I think that Marlene sent that chapter out. If not, I'm happy to also send it out. And some of you may have read it. And then the second reason she wanted to make sure that we talked about this is that I think all of you, as kind of you have said, you've been on this group for a while, because there are very very powerful emotions that have gone with your own process of becoming Christians and then moving beyond Christianity. And what you find is that even after moving beyond Christianity, it's often emotions that can trigger a sense of misgiving or doubt, and that even when you can kind of look back at the beliefs that you've left behind, sometimes that you can say rationally, this doesn't make any sense, or historically, I know where those beliefs in the Bible came from, or I've done my homework, and I can tell you what the lineage is of this specific doctrine or dogma, and yet there still can be a lingering anxiety or sense of misgiving about that. And so it's helpful for us to talk about what those feelings are, why they can be so powerful, and why why they hang on so long and so tight, and then what are perhaps some things you can do to get rid of them. So I want to talk a little bit in the abstract about this stuff, and then very briefly, and then basically open it up for questions in a conversation.
Okay.
Go ahead, Marlene.
Oh, no, I just said okay. That sounds good.
Okay. The question of does emotion validate belief is, in ironically, a question that has both a yes answer and a no answer. The yes answer is that in the end, any belief we have that we hold is held only because we have a sense of knowing or an emotion that kind of gives us a sense that that belief is true. And without that emotion, that sense of knowing, we kind of can't land on a belief. We end up kind of caught in limbo. Robert Burton's book on Being Certain does a gorgeous job of describing this. And if you haven't read it, I highly recommend it. But one of the things he talks about is that sense of knowing, which he describes as an emotion, kind of that feeling of certainty or kind of feeling that something at a gut level just seems right or true, that confidence or certitude is an involuntary reaction. It's an emotion, just like having a surge of love or fear. It's not something that we have control over. And it's something that can be triggered by reason and by evidence, but it's also something can be triggered by a whole host of other factors, including a situation that has been specifically manipulated by an evangelist. By a kind of semi-hypnotic experience, by kind of music, by the kinds of processes and procedures that have evolved over time within Christianity to elicit and maintain belief. It can also is a feeling that can be triggered by mental illness or can be precluded by mental illness. So in Burton's book, for example, he talks about very simple kind of familiar examples that people who kind of are have compulsive hand washing, and no matter how many times, no matter how thoroughly they wash their hands, no matter what they scrub with, no matter how many kind of cleansers they use, they can't feel like their hands are clean. He talks about, on the other hand, the schizophrenics who like have the sense of certainty that they are being watched, whether it's by the CIA or kind of by Big Brother or by a kind of satanic conspiracy. And no matter how much reasoning and evidence you might provide to the contrary, that feeling of certainty is so powerful that it overrides anything else and leads them to kind of generate rationalization. So that feeling of confidence or the lack of a feeling of confidence can override mountains and mountains of evidence. It's a very powerful experience. And basically what we can hope for is that for the most part, our feeling of certainty, a feeling of knowing kind of lines up with real world evidence, with rationality, with empiricism, and it's kind of good enough for us to get around. And what the scientific method does is it kind of bakes in a bunch of kind of corrective measures to try to force our collective feeling of knowing to kind of obligate it to some rules, to what we call falsifiability, to kind of build in some protections against us going down a bunch of rabbit holes and then feeling certain that we know things that in fact are actually false about the causes and effects in this world. But our feeling of certainty is also, and our feeling of knowing is also quite prone to error. So that's the kind of yes/no of this. And one of the ways that the feeling of knowing and the feeling of certainty is prone to error is in the religious arena, as we all know from our very, very profound experiences with religious fundamentalism. And there's a whole host of other emotions that you all have experienced at a deep personal level that are used by religion to propagate itself and to reinforce belief. So the feeling of guilt, the feeling of being inadequate, being kind of a worthless sinner, that is then relieved when you confess your sins and pray for forgiveness. The kind of euphoria that can come from having the sense that those sins are actually forgiven. The sense of wonder and joy at being kind of present in a community of believers and participating in the worship experience. The incredible sense of relief that can come when you finally give in after having been singled out by a minister, or what feels like the conviction of having been singled out by God himself, and then giving into that, and then having the floods of kind of joy and relief, and sometimes incredible behavior change that can come after that, finding that symptoms like addictions or depression or other things are at least temporarily gone. And so these are fantastically powerful emotions that all reinforce belief, even though we all know now in hindsight that they can reinforce beliefs that are perfectly false, as well as beliefs that are backed up by solid reason and evidence. So let me stop there, because I feel like this is a kind of monologue with me talking to a set of question marks on my computer. And what I'd like to do is just give you a chance to respond and to start asking questions and then open up a conversation so that we're actually talking about the things that are most important to you, not just the things that are coming to the front of my mind.
I think it's fascinating that the sense of knowing is an actual feeling, that's a visceral kind of feeling, that's something that happens in the brain. That's not just a cognition.
Right. And part of the way we know that is because you know, one of the ways we've discovered that is because of all of the disorders in which that sense of knowing can go wrong, right? When there's mm-hmm. a brain injury or when there's some kind of degenerative process. So, V.S. Ramachandran talks. He's got a TED talk in which he describes this incredible experience of a person having what's called Capra syndrome, and her son coming into the room, or it's the son, I think it's the mother coming into the room, and not having a feeling of knowing that is the mother, and saying, this person looks exactly like my mother, but it is not my mother,
yeah.
Right?
Uh-huh.
And because the feeling is missing, the patient who has had a brain lesion is absolutely confident that person who looks in every way, and they will acknowledge this person looks in every way, they sound in every way, they have every kind of detail that would kind of be precisely the same as the mother, can't be the mother because that feeling of knowing is missing.
Valerie, this is Oscar. I am. If I could jump in here and just make a comment and maybe a question too, I mentioned in my check-in that I had a couple of little boy type tirades this week in my anger toward fundamentalism and the way Jesus is often presented in the Bible, kind of the hard Jesus. And it was triggered. I realized it was triggered. I had gone back and I hadn't listened to any Christian music in a long time. And since I'm a musician, I love music. And I went back and I listened to this old Phil Keaggy CD. And some of you may know that he's this really great guitar player and he sings like Paul McCartney. And these songs were so well-crafted. And they literally sounded like what the Beatles would have sounded like had they stayed together and continued to grow musically. And he was, but the rhetoric was so dark. It was filled with all these images of, giving up everything you own and following Jesus and what a dark world it is and how good God is to us in this dark world and how he draws us. And I listened to three or four songs and I kept getting more and more nauseated, and to the point where it literally triggered one of these tirades and kind of upset my week greatly. This was earlier in the week. So if you could comment some on that, because you mentioned how music could be sort of a really powerful trigger to this.
Well, one of the ways that music often functions is that, in a religious context, is that when we are listening to music, we aren't subjecting the content of what we're hearing to a rational analytic process, right? We are absorbing it and responding to it in a different way. We are kind of experiencing it viscerally, kind of we're experiencing it kind of through our bodies and through our senses. Brian, Oscar, you can probably articulate this better than I can, actually. But then the content of those words slips past the kind of standards of evidence and the critical thinking that we would normally apply if somebody who can be a scientist during the week and then walk in and sit down and listen to listen to music on Sunday and not have the experience you're having because they're listening to the music in a different way. So what happened to you now as an outsider going back and listening to those songs, you were really listening and hearing the words and thinking about the moral and social implications. You were thinking about the implications, the consequences of those words and the whole, what I would describe as a meme complex of Christianity in your life. And it feels very different to listen to the music when you've got that part of your brain engaged.
Yeah, like 30 years ago when I first got sucked into fundamentalist Christianity in college, you know, Phil Keaggy was huge back then. And this particular CD is about 20 years old. It was part of my reintroduction to fundamentalism in the mid-90s. But the bottom line is I realized it's like I had almost, without critical thinking skills and without a solid family to be grounded in that was emotionally healthy, which I did not have, I was a sitting duck for this. You know, I was your typical teenager, awkward and, you know, moody and not one of the popular ones, but very into music. And no wonder, I look back and I'm not astonished at all that I got sucked into fundamentalism through this piece.
Valerie, the manipulation, I think, is an important factor. And in retrospect, I think a number of people can think of ways in which they were in religious situations, whether it was a church service or otherwise, where there was music, or there were group effects that were pressured. I mean, they were engineered such that a situation was created to create certain feelings, and then those feelings get attributed to the religious beliefs, the religious dogma. And I have said a few times to people that one thing that religious folks never want to know about, I mean, they never want to know much about psychology in general, and that there are some things that psychology knows a lot about that are pretty devastating, and one is attribution theory. You know, like, you can attribute those feelings to anything you want. And so if you attribute them to the Holy Spirit, or you attribute them to the truth of whatever it is that you're being told, the belief, and making that connection, then that's one thing. But you could also attribute it to a drug high, or something you ate, or the connection you feel with all these people, or, you know, the oneness of the universe, or whatever. But if you attribute it to the religion, or to the beliefs, or to the Holy Spirit, then that connection can be made in a very solid way, so that later on you still think that every time you have that feeling that that's what it is, or that, and then when you leave the religion that and you have certain feelings, that that's the Holy Spirit calling you back. It was interesting when I was in Salt Lake City recently, and I went to hear the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, and I'm sitting there with my ex-Mormon client, who was like a really dedicated, serious Mormon for a lot of years, and I was a little concerned that this would be triggering for him, but we sat there, and of course the choir was amazing. And this is in the tabernacle, right, with all these amazing acoustics. And they sang a number of songs, but they sang a couple that I knew. They sang Rock of Ages, right? This giant choir sings Rock of Ages. And, of course, it was beautiful and amazing, and it brought back memories. You know, the comfort and the warmth, and after when it was all over, you know, we talked about. I said, how did all that feel for you? You know, and he said, and I thought maybe he'd be upset and all, but he said, no, just like visiting grandma's house or something, you know, and for me it was triggering and it made me sad. I think I might have even shed a tear. But wow, you know, it's the attribution. And in Mormonism, it's the feeling is the proof. When they get that feeling, they call it a testimony. And it's proof. It's proof that the Book of Mormon is true. That's what that feeling means.
You know, the Mormon temples are built in many ways, kind of, they've got very high ceilings. They're dramatic. They've got dramatic architecture. Partly that is to attract people from the outside. But there's been some interesting research done on the architecture of Gothic cathedrals, for example. And one of the things they found is that those very high spaces actually have an effect on the cerebellum, and they create a kind of disorientation in the cerebellum, the part of our brain that affects balance and a sense of our ability to orient in space, and that's part of what triggers our sense of transcendence in a space like that or among gigantic redwood trees or whatever. Right.
Wow.
I find that feeling of I love being in spaces like that.
Uh-huh.
But again, it's like one of the things that religions have instinctively, they landed on it. They didn't know the cerebellum existed back when Gothic cathedrals were first designed, right?
Yeah.
But they landed on it as a way of kind of, as you said, as a way of kind of creating this proof of the existence of God without even realizing that that was what exactly it was that they were manipulating.
I was in St. Peter's, too. That was the same thing.
What's that?
St. Peter's. When I was in Italy, I was at St. Peter's, and it was the same thing.
Yeah.
For the cathedral.
So, Valerie, you don't think the ancient popes and bishops understood that?
Oh, I think I think they knew that it made them feel closer to God. I don't think they knew exactly. I don't think they knew the mechanism. We now know the mechanism, and I think that's what's so great about what Marlene was talking about. When you understand the psychology of it or the biology of it, mm-hmm. then you can make other attributions. You understand that it's a natural phenomenon, that it has to do with how our bodies react to this natural world. It's not about some otherworldly kind of cause and effect.
Yeah, attribution means, you know, I'm feeling this way because, you know, my brain is doing this, rather than I'm feeling this way because the Book of Mormon is true.
The same thing happens with conversion experiences. So if you look at, for example, Flo Conway and Seligman's book, Snapping, they describe these incredibly transformative conversion experiences, like when people have a born-again experience, and what's amazing is that they show how the experience of transformation is almost identical whether you are being born again as an evangelical or as a Mooney or you're in certain kinds of other cults, right? And it's that what's not the unique kind of critical factor isn't the presence of Jesus and the Holy Spirit. The critical factor is a sequence of certain kinds of social processes and pressures and emotions that can then trigger this kind of feeling of being broken down and born again and then a kind of euphoric transformation. And so again, they have that experience. They have no explanation other than the one that's being handed to them by the folks who are around them who are saying, this is the power of Jesus or the power of the Holy Spirit at work in your life. And it's such a powerful experience that they take that explanation and believe it. Mm-hmm. Mariana, you were waiting to ask a question.
Yeah. Okay. You mentioned something about having misgivings despite knowing. And it's like, I know a lot of it like originated from previous myths, you know, like the Egyptian myths, the Assyrian myths and stuff like that, right? And sometimes it's just as unreal as all those myths, you know? But there are times in which sometimes it can seem almost as real as real history, like stories of various presidents and stuff, you know what I'm saying? Does that ever go away, or is it something that's stuck there for the rest of your life because you were indoctrinated in it and stuff? Did that come out right?
Uh-huh. Well, so one thing that helps might help to remember is that a lot of the stories that you've read of presidents are made up.
Well, yeah, like Abraham Lincoln, and I cannot tell. Is he the one that couldn't tell a lie? I get him mixed up.
No.
And George Washington chopped down the cherry tree? Yeah, that's
it. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that one's not even true.
In that, you know, like basically we whenever kind of powerful people exist in history, we take those people who are complicated. They are complicated bipedal primates, just like us, and we immediately start weaving kind of narrating mythologies around them. But like the question that you asked about it, kind of feeling the kind of biblical narrative and mythologies feeling real, more real than those more distant ones, I think that that when those things get inside you as a child, when you're indoctrinated, when someone is indoctrinated in the way that you were, and when you have the surrounding culture continuing to kind of give off, you know, we've got presidential candidates who are living their lives as if these things were real. We just had our whole Congress reaffirm the words "In God We Trust" as our national motto, for goodness sake. That it makes sense that your ability to hold on to your own fragile sense of what's real can get easily disrupted. We are social animals, and our sense we rely on other people to kind of provide feedback to us about what is real. Our sense of reality is socially constructed, and our ability to kind of weave our way through and to hold fast to reason and evidence is tenuous. And so I, you know, kind of, this might be disappointing, but I would expect that, honestly, that it will continue to be something you have to kind of call on the adult self and call on the other people who are part of your rational secular community to keep kind of reinforcing the part of you that has kind of set aside childish ways.
Yeah. Set aside childish ways.
Huh? You know, this is Oscar again. My own experience really confirms that, because in my 5-year renaissance, toward the end, I departed from my secular community and from most of my, you know, rational, free-thinking, skeptical friends. And that's one of the things that allowed me to get sucked back in.
Mm-hmm. The virus, as they already calls it, can be pretty strong, you know, and it doesn't seem like you ever get rid of the virus entirely. You know what I'm saying? It's like there's still a wee bit that can be triggered, even though you think it's all gone, and you just can't even imagine how you believed such a myth before, you know? And then something say something, and then to, you know, remind myself that this is just rewritten myth set to a particular culture and stuff. And, you know, there's moments in which I end up questioning myself, like, what if you're wrong, kind of thing, you know? And it's like, you know, sometimes I wonder, how can I be wrong, you know? If this and this is true, then it's a myth. Did that come out right?
Yeah. I have a friend here in the Seattle area who is an 85-year-old. He hasn't been a Christian for, probably 25 years. But he has prostate cancer, and as he comes closer to what he knows is the end of his life, he finds himself assaulted by these kind of childhood fears of hell, right? And he, every rational fiber in his body, as an, you know, somebody who has set that aside long ago, knows that it can't possibly be true, but his defenses are weakened by fatigue, by illness, and by that kind of the decline that comes with all of us near the end, to all of us near the end. And there are times when he needs somebody else to say, it's not possible. It's
that
just not possible.
That scares the hell out of me, and that could happen when I'm older and like 80 years old. You know, that really scares me to death.
That's why it's abuse. That's why it's abuse to teach this, you know. Because it's so hard to eradicate later.
I don't want to go back to it when I'm like in my 80s and then, you know what I'm saying? And then lose my mind again because of it, you know?
Ronnie, do you have some question here?
It's funny, Miranda, that you should say that. I was just saying to my partner earlier on that, you know, I'm making little steps forward and I'm kind of now thinking, well, I can see that things like the Bible can't be God's word as I used to believe. But then I think, oh, God, you know, if I get something bad happens in life, I'm just terrified that I'll be sucked back into this convenient set of certainties. And it really scares me, you know, that I won't be strong enough to resist that. So that I can really relate to that. Something I was just thinking today, actually. So
the feelings that you have there are what? What are the feelings that make you feel like you should go back?
Just that set of convenient certainties that made everything so easy and answered everything and gave a pat answer to all those questions, you know, and gave me an answer to why am I here. And it just, with me having quite an inquiring mind and quite a scientific mind, I quite like answers to things and answers to puzzles. And fundamentalism was something that, despite being, you know, reasonably bright, I just accepted completely because it provided a kind of an answer and an emotional certainty to a question about, well, what happens after I die. And I think one of the things I try and reassure myself about now is that, well, if I get scared about things like hell, then this idea of God that put that there is not one that I've either known, loved, or ever worshipped truly. So it's not something I can just convince my mind is true again. So that helps, but there's still that, I guess, childish fear that I'll get sucked back in if something really bad does happen, and you know, that's kind of scary to me, I think.
Valerie?
So I think, you know, one of the things that the mere fact that you're here having this conversation makes that less likely, and I think it's helpful to remember that you are doing the things that make you more build your immune system against that. Part of it is having a community, having had these conversations, having people around you, even when they are scattered across the planet, who have borne witness to your journey, rather than taking that journey in isolation. Another part of what I think of as kind of strengthening your immune system is girding yourself with information. There's information now that we have that was never available to past generations of people who were skeptics and doubters. They had to make all of these kind of convoluted philosophical arguments and theological arguments, and yes, the moral arguments were there, but they didn't really have the information, for example, about cognition and learning that allows us to really understand the psychobiology of all of this, to understand why Christianity is so powerful. We didn't understand how mind viruses work in the past. We have a much better understanding, not a complete understanding, but a much better understanding than ever we did before. So before, there are alternative attributions were much weaker. And I think we also didn't understand past generation didn't understand the history of the Bible in the way we do now. That kind of when that if you kind of really kind of have looked at the scholarship about the Bible and have seen the ways that the Bible contains embedded in it the arguments that were going on within Judaism itself, the fact that kind of early Judaism in fact had human sacrifice and polytheism as orthodox practice, and that there was kind of the Bible is not a monolith; it's a kind of series of arguments and competitions, and kind of, you know, in each case you're getting half of an argument from each of the Bible writers, and it becomes almost you can kind of build enough, you can kind of create enough information in your brain that it becomes and a social network that such that it becomes almost impossible for you to go get sucked back in, at least until the point that, you know, dementia sets in, in which case, we might all end up religious, but we probably won't mind.
Yeah.
It's funny. What do you think about that? She's saying something, Ronnie, that kind of backs up what I was saying to you about really having a lot of information that helps you to thoroughly debunk the Bible, because, some of the fears that you have are about whether or not the Bible is true.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, you're not worried about whether the Quran is true.
Well, yeah, that's so true. And, if I sort of were to hear somebody claim to have a vision or a dream or an experience in some other religion that I've not heard of, I'd have no trouble in my mind dismissing that just out of hand. And that's not difficult for me at all. And then if I hear somebody or remember a memory of somebody in church saying something about some dream they'd had or some experience or some thing, it's that much more real and that much more difficult to shake off. And so I think, like you say, I was gradually getting to that point where even this weekend I was thinking about all my kind of universalist theology that I was involved in. I kind of see now, well, the verses you're using were written decades later after these events occurred, so how can you claim it's the word of God? So I sense little bits of progress in myself and little steps.
Ronnie, one book I loved recently is called The Human Faces of God.
And oh, yeah.
Have you read that one?
I haven't actually. Marlene mentioned it, that you'd recommended it. Yeah,
yeah, it's worth picking up because it's actually written by someone who's a modernist Christian theologian. He hasn't discarded the tradition altogether, but I think that his, seeing the Bible through his eyes makes it almost impossible to see it as anything other than the work of our ancestors who were struggling to make sense of this world and their own experience of it as best they possibly could.
Right. Oh, brilliant. That sounds great.
Yeah, and I've suggested that that in this group, if there are books that people want to suggest to have a kind of book club experience, that would be great. And this is one I think would be a good idea.